He said, this is basically a camouflaged loan, and the profit that the bank is taking, again, is not halal. And again, his observations, if you link it to the time in which he lived, was basically a time when a lot of institutions in Pakistan, where he lived, were basically engaging in fictitious, murabahs. There was no asset backing or nothing. Basically, paper transactions were being done on a wide scale, and the regulator itself didn't have the knowledge or understanding. And those were the days when Islamization was talked about in Pakistan in a big way, and they wanted to Islamize the entire financial system. Many people took advantage of that, and they would apparently do a murabaha, but basically there will be no sale or no purchase, nothing. Basically, it will be the same conventional transaction in the guise of an Islamic transaction. So he again completely rejected murabaha. He came up with the idea of time multiplied counter loans. He said that you can just basically, Qarz-e-Hasana is the recommended form of financing in Islam, and in which obviously there is no room for any excess is riba. So the only way you can perhaps get a compensation is through time. If you give a loan for, let's say, $100 for 1 year, is equivalent to $200 for half a year. So that's how banks can trade amongst themselves and customers can trade amongst themselves. So his work was basically a theoretical work, which was presented to the Council of Islamic Ideology in Pakistan when it went about the task of Islamization. Unfortunately, rightly or wrongly, they didn't see much merit in his formulation, because he was he offered that as the only solution. He rejected Musharaka, he rejected Murabaha. Not other Islamic economists quite agreed with that. And they also didn't reject this TMCL or time multiplier counter loan outright, but they said it can be used in a limited way for working capital financing by banks or for their interbank transactions. But they never explored the idea further. And in fact, this theory building was quickly, as we briefly traced the history of Islamic banking, was followed by practices. And now it is the practices that dominate the theory building. The theoreticians, they lag behind. They see some product coming up and being marketed aggressively. Then they go out to see if it is Sharia compliant, what are the economic implications, and so on and so forth. But that was a time when Mahmud Ahmed lived. He wrote his book, and Dr. Badrul Khan took it forward, when there were large-scale fraudulent mechanisms going on with respect to Murabaha, with respect to Musharaka, and so on. But later on, these were found to be the primary Islamic financial products.
We have time constraint. We have time constraint, and therefore this gentleman has asked for the first.
My question is, where to study? If my student wants
to
study.
That will cover.
Can I answer you after the session, inshallah?
So due to time constraint, we had to apologize that we have to at least stop at 11 o'clock, and therefore we will be able to entertain only one more question. And of course, doctor's address is known to everybody, and we will pass the email ID also, and any questions can be passed to him, and he will be able to answer.
Yes, of course. There are Islamic funds which are marketing their products. And even in India, we have new funds, Sharia compliant funds that have come to the fore. Now, to answer your question properly, for example, you're an individual investor, you would like to directly invest. So you don't have to invest indirectly through the mutual funds. You can invest in stock markets. There is a basic rule which you have to guard, is your tendency to speculate. Now, our Sharia scholars, they did not proclaim stock market investing as un-Islamic, primarily because the intention of an individual when we decide to invest in a particular company is largely hidden to an outsider. So if you are going ahead and investing, whether you want to hold on to the stock for a very long period of time as a genuine investor, and you have done the proper study of the company and you find the company to be good enough to invest in, and you are looking forward to higher incomes, higher dividends in the years to come, or you are an investor, you claim yourself to be an investor, but basically you have been driven into investment when you have found your neighbor making enormous profits through day trading or day-to-day speculation, and you go to the stock market in the morning and your intention is to get out of, to sell the stock by afternoon and make whatever profits or losses are there in the price differences. So this action, until it takes place in an the event has taken place, if you ask me, I can tell you that yes, or if you reveal your intention, I can tell you that yes, your intention was un-Islamic or your intention was okay. But the fact is that no Sharia scholar can generalize a pronouncement that yes, everyone is putting his money just for speculation, or everyone is a genuine investor. So that's the reason why they have basically shied away from giving a verdict of impermissibility on stock markets and so on. It is generally found to be permissible, provided the company in which you are investing doesn't engage in any activity which is outright haram, for example, manufacture of breweries or pork and so on. So basic line of activity has to be halal. That is the most important criteria, because when you are investing your money, you are becoming effectively, in the eyes of Sharia, a partner in the business. So you have to take care of that. Second thing is, some of the activities could be, not exactly Islamic. For example, the bank has raised some equity, 80% are funds it has raised is through share capital, which is halal, but 20% it has borrowed on the basis of interest. And if you look around, almost every company that you come across would have done some borrowing or lending based on interest. Now, does it mean that the Muslim investor cannot invest? You have to rule out, because he's a partner and he shares in the sin of investing in sinful activities of borrowing and lending on interest. Our Sharia scholars, generally, they have refrained from proclaiming this as a impermissible activity. Why? Because that would rule out completely any kind of investment by the Muslims who have surplus funds. And as a community, if you ask me as an individual, I would be guided, perhaps I can advise you that you just refrain from it. Don't get into stock market. There's real estate you can invest in. But if you ask me as a community, if I'm a faqih, I would be very, very careful in telling you, no, it is haram. Because if I say this is haram, and the entire community refrains from doing this, there is a cost to the community. Individually, certain costs could be tolerated if you are, more fearful, and some other person is less fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then there are different degrees of, faith and degrees which varies from person to person. So when it is a prescription for the community, generally they have been more liberal. A faqih would always take a more liberal approach. And they have found that as long as some impermissible element in the company's activities, because after all, we are not responsible for the day-to-day managerial decisions. We are only indirectly investing. We are indirect partners. We are not direct partners like a musharaka in the classical sense as it prevailed in the times of the companions. Now we invest, we are partners technically, but we don't have a say in the management. Apart from in the annual general meeting, we can raise our hands, we can do little. If you want to walk into the premises of the company, we don't have the permission to do so. So even if we are partners. So basically we cannot be held accountable for every other thing that could be impermissible or changes from one day to another. So they say that as long as an investor, you have access to what is available to you, information, annual reports. So look at the annual reports. If you find the company has borrowed or lent substantially on the basis of interest, refrain from it. For example, a conventional bank. All scholars agree that you cannot invest in a conventional bank. But if it is a company, for example, a known IT company, Infosys, very small percentage of its financing is done through debt, conventional debt. Most of it is equity. It's an equity. Its capital structure is dominated by equity. Now, they will say, as long as something is not significant, just ignore it. and their rule of, again, fiqhi rule they employ. Significant, something becomes significant, and an Islamic element, when it exceeds one third of the total. This is a fiqhi rule which they employ. So as long as, let's say, the interest-bearing debt is less than one third, or the amount of interest is one third, according to our contemporary scholar, this is a very contemporary problem, and that's why you have the contemporary fatwa on it. You don't have the early scholars commenting on stock investment and so on. So the contemporary kind of consensus that one-third rule is one can follow. As long as the, you know, the un-Islamic element is less than one-third, it can be tolerated. It doesn't make the whole thing haram, and not every Muslim is, you know, recommended to refrain from it.
My question is,
yeah.
You covered the topic in a very simple manner. You said they, but the topic, one thing is that where to study our children, we want them to study Islamic banking.
Yeah.
My son is studying where you talk about it, IIM in Jeddah, Malaysia.
Okay.
He's doing his graduation. I think this is last year. He'll be completing his graduation in finance. And inshallah, he wants to do ACCA and banking, Islamic banking. Now he's confused.
Okay, as far as ACCA is concerned, it is value neutral. It's a technique that you have to learn how to, yes. And ACCA itself has also introduced a diploma, specific courses on Islamic banking and finance, because for Islamic organizations, of course, the accounting techniques need some modification and so on. Where your son is studying presently, they have a very good program in Islamic banking. It's part of the BBA program, it's part of the MBA program, and the management center in IIUM, it offers a master's program in Islamic banking, postgraduate diploma program. And there's another very recently established institution, not very recent, already 2-3 years old, INSIF, International Center for Islamic Finance, which markets itself as the, you know, global destination for Islamic finance education. It is backed by the Bank Negara. Bank Negara has contributed very generously for creating this institution. And that is the Malaysian brand of Islamic finance. I would like to add this qualification. If you come to the Middle East, or if you come and go to the Indian subcontinent, there are some subtle differences, fortunately, because we see a good integration there among the Sharia scholars. In the 90s, we used to talk about this Southeast Asian Islamic finance, Middle Eastern Islamic finance, because there were very sharp points of differences. Currently, the differences are, you know, getting marginalized, getting resolved through greater deliberation among the scholars and so on. But still, some points of concern do remain. There are some specific products which are found to be quite okay as far as the Malaysian financial system goes. And learning that, of course, doesn't mean that you become un-Islamic or you participate in those transactions. When, you know, subsequent to your education, you'll get a complete education, certainly, in INSEF, or you do it in a UK. Now in UK also, there are a couple of universities which have come forward with not only masters, but also doctoral programs. Durham University is offering a very good PhD program in Islamic finance. And, Cash, a school of management, many more actually. Every other day you find a new addition. It is a matter of, I think, your son to decide whether he wants to specialize in accounting and then look at the Islamic finance sector, because ACCA would basically equip him with some very good tools of analysis. And an ACCA can work in Islamic bank, certainly, can work in any Islamic organization, can contribute to the discipline of Islamic accounting. And in fact, it is the view of the Malaysian Accounting Standards Board. Recently, they came up with this view that you don't need separate Islamic accounting for the Islamic organizations. The conventional accounting tools are good enough for Islamic banks and financial institutions. So it's a choice. It's not a choice between what to study, but it's a choice between what to study and where to work. Yes, of course. There are many more, in fact. If you want, I can send you a complete list of such institutions, and then you can go visit their websites and make your own rational decision. It's okay, yeah. You are right. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, it was a wonderful evening for all of us. It so started that in a very small group of, we have actually Indian Islamic Center, Azizia Area Committee is having a weekly discussion class. In one of this discussion class, this subject was discussed, Islamic finance. You know, in Kerala, the issue is getting discussed. So there, we discussed and we found that we need to bring an expert to discuss the subject. That's how we search who is the expert available. Alhamdulillah, today we are all very happy to have Dr. Baidullah here. And we believe that this is a start of a dialogue. We are, as per Dr. Baidullah's, one of the major takeaway for me is that the responsibility lies with people like us. We have to demand, we as customers, if we demand from the banks, they will definitely follow the rules, inshallah. So that's where I think we have to move ahead. We have to say sorry for not able to attending all the questions, because the time limitations are there. This subject has a lot of other dimensions to be discussed, like the possibilities of studies, educational institutes availability. This is a job opportunity from this is going to be huge in the future, inshallah. We need to explore these things. We need to have better awareness about the subject. At the end of the day, it's our responsibility that we are, the Muslims, has to be, from the burden of riba. If at least we are able to reduce that, if we are all pulled into that system, if you are able to get away, if this dialogue becomes a start point for that, today we are all, alhamdulillah, grateful to Allah. My responsibility is to thank all of you. Let me thank Dr. Baidullah for his wonderful presentation, Dr. Sheikh Muhammad Subhi, the director of Dawa Center, Dr. Muhammad, sir, from university, he is the advisory board chairman of Saudi Indian Islahi Center. Let me thank Mr. Musa Koya, president of Indian Islahi Center Jeddah, Ms. Hasenar, the president of Indian Islahi Center Azizia Area Committee. Let me thank all of you for coming up and let's take the oath that this is a starting point. We have to have more dialogues on this subject, and this will be, we will work hard in the subject, inshallah.
Let me. The email ID of Dr. Baidullah so that people can ask their question through email. So, nobody will not be satisfied.
Yeah, let me read out the email address. It's m_OBAIDULLAH, Obaidullah. Let me repeat, m_OBAIDULLAH@yahoo.com. Let me just make a small announcement about program tomorrow evening. This is in public lecture by Abu Musab Wajdi Akari on the topic, The Eternal Miracle. The program will be at Imbala Auditorium tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. Sharafiya. Assalamu alaikum.